And I want to thank AMI and Susan Tomlinson Schmidt for the invitation to come to speak with you this morning. This is one of my favorite things on the planet to do, to be with emerging leaders. And so it is really a gift to me. So I hope it's good for you as well. And I'd love to have a conversation at the end. So I want to go through my remarks relatively quickly, and then let's engage in a conversation. That work for you all? Let's build some energy here. So I want to throw out a couple of things to start with. 20 to 25,000 years. Remember that? I'm going to come back to that. And I also want to highlight for a moment the theme of the conference and just stop and really nail the word, not innovation, but the verb innovate, which is on that, on your programs, to change something that is established. It's a very powerful thought if you really think about it, that this organization, you all here, have opted in to a posture towards the world around you of changing. So it raises a couple of questions, and I want to get to those in a minute. The first thing I want to do, though, is just make sure everyone understands independent sector, because I'm going to invite you to be a part of us in a way that is new, is hopefully an innovation. But independent sector was founded about 36 years ago, in 1980, at a very tumultuous time in the country around the nonprofit and philanthropic sector. And the goal of the organization was very, very simple. It had two purposes, and those purposes are still very much what we do today. The first is we are a community-building organization. We believe that leaders from across the country do phenomenal work when they come together and are in relationship with each other, not so much transactionally, but in a way of building an understanding of what's going on, of sharing your successes and your failures and your dreams. And over the last 36 years, we have watched the Independent Sector National Conference catalyze and unleash incredible amounts of innovation. So we do that annually. We do it usually in the fall, in October, and we're gonna talk a little bit about that in a minute. The second thing we do is we harness the wisdom of community and we channel it into public policy, to advocacy. We believe at a very fundamental level that you, practitioners, leaders in the community, understand what is effective for public policy in America. And we demand that policymakers pay attention to our collective wisdom. So that's what we do. Think of us like the Chamber of Commerce for the nonprofit and philanthropic sector. So let's go back to you all. Innovate, this posture to create change in something that exists. So it raises a question. What are you trying to change? And why are you doing it? So I think there's a very simple question we all have to ask ourselves. I've experienced this in my 50 years, entirely in the social sector. And that is, every time I have a conversation with folks, they just want to do good in the world, right? It doesn't get more complicated than that. They will express it in a variety of ways. Oh, I want to feed and hunger. Oh, I'd love to come up with an app that allows for folks who don't have access to credit to actually get cheap credit so that they can build a credit score and then become a small business person. They express it in lots of ways. But behind it, if you really ask them, like, look, I'm just trying to leave the world a little bit better than I found it. Do people feel that? Would you agree with that? Throw your hands up if you don't think that all of us in here are really trying to do some good in the world. I know it's a little bit, but there's got to be somebody out there that doesn't think that. All right, so we're in agreement. So then it raises a question for us of what does it mean to do good? And the name of this address is, do institutions kill the ability for you all, me, to innovate, to make a good contribution to the existing organizations? It's actually a fundamental question that we as a nation, we as a world, are facing. You see enormous, enormous changes going on. This fourth industrial revolution of technology you hear a great deal about, the incredible shift globalization is creating in commerce and the economy and employment. major changes in the environment, right, that are creating huge shifts in populations. The extremely exciting and challenging issues around diversity, equity, inclusion, both racial as well as economic here in this country. We are faced with actually, in many regards, some of the most difficult challenges we have in probably the last 100 years as a nation. So you all are about to walk out into 50 years of a career, 20 to 25,000 years of innovation. And you have to make choices. This room, 20 to 25,000 years, you have to make a choice about how you're going to dedicate your desire to do good, to transform what is existing. It's an awesome opportunity, and it should be a little bit intimidating. So how do you think about doing that? And so the name of this talk is, Do Institutions Kill Innovation? And my experience is the answer to that is yes and no. And it really depends on us. It wasn't lost on me just before the talk. You saw the scrolling of the institutions that were hoping you were paying attention and thinking about careers. Did you notice most of those were big, large, legacy institutions? They need you. We need you. So I believe institutions are critically important in America. And I think you have choices about where you want to do good, where you want to learn from those institutions to be able to co-create and innovate. So clearly in America, we have a history of being a nation grounded in religion. I myself spent the first probably 20 years of my life as a social sector person in religious institutions. They were transformative. They both squashed my ability to innovate, and they nurtured and unleashed my ability to innovate. I made a choice. I grew up in a religiously conservative, but extremely socially progressive Catholic family. And it afforded me an incredible set of opportunities. In my early 30s, I discovered a world that was this incredible mix of social sector institutions, conservancy organizations, arts institutions, community-based multi-service organizations. The list is endless, and the choices are remarkable. Unlike me, you all have an opportunity to think about the for-profit world. When I was coming of age, you wore a black hat or you wore a white hat. Unfair as it is, it's how we thought about it. Your generation doesn't think so much in those terms. You can look to things like corporate social responsibility, B Corps, as mechanisms for unleashing incredible amounts of good. You have a choice about these institutions. And then finally, we're living in a time where you all can imagine doing your own nonprofit, stepping outside of traditional institutions like Black Lives Matter, and organizing. They are institutions, but they're not traditional institutions. So I stop because this has been our experience at the independent sector. We have this national purview, and we spent the last 2.5 years looking across America and saying, what is happening? And what does it mean for the future? And we think that we're at this adaptive moment in the social sector. We have to invent what the social sector is going to look like in the future. And we absolutely need you all to partner with us, not as recipients of our great wisdom, but as co-creators and innovators moving forward. So in that in mind, I wanted a better sense of who you all were in the room. So when we had a conversation, I had a little bit of a sense of where you were coming from. So some of you filled out a survey. We sent it out to all of you. Not everybody filled it out, but that's OK. I realized it was finals time. And so there's some interesting data that helped me understand who I was talking to. The first is this notion about religion. If you didn't notice, religion plays an increasing role, again, in the American discourse. And religious institutions themselves are changing. Some are morphing in remarkable ways, and others are not. What was interesting to me about you all is that unlike your millennial and centennial peers, who actually see a much more suppressed notion of the value of religion, you in this room actually see religious institutions as having value, much higher than your millennial peers. and even higher than my generation. That caught my attention immensely. I had a suspicion, and I'd love to have a conversation, that because the world is changing and we have such dynamism, the search for the answer to what is good in the world, we turn to traditional religious institutions to help us figure that out. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. The second question we asked you about was around your thoughts about the for-profit world and the ability to do good and your potential interest in exploring doing good with for-profits. You all trend very much with your generation and higher than mine. I go back to that black hat, white hat thing. I think this is excellent news for the sector. And I'll say this little piece of it. If you aspire to scale social change, we have to learn from the for-profit sector about using market-driven strategies to scale impact. So you all are sitting in an extremely important place to be able to learn those skills and bring them into traditional organizations. And finally, this is what really caught my attention and why I framed the talk I did. You all score much higher than my generation in believing that institutions matter. This is in direct counterpoint to what we hear and know from surveys, Pew being one of them, about your generation wanting to step outside of traditional institutions and do your own thing. This is really, really good news for those of us in leadership now. Because there was a growing fear among my generation that managing millennials or having them run around to five different organizations meant you were going to have an unstable workforce. Those may be issues that have more to do with us than with you, but the fact that this organization, AMI, and you in the room believe institutions matter is extremely encouraging news. So much so that we at Independent Sector, when we got this data back from you, said, wait a minute, there is a really important trend or opportunity here. So we sat down with AMI and said, hey, we have an idea we'd love to explore with you, and we'd love to innovate. We'd love to try something and see how it works. So today, I'd really love to invite you all into an experiment with us at Independent Sector, this Washington-based organization that can be removed from what's going on. Normally, our membership, we're a membership organization, 500, 600 institutions, not individual memberships. So from the large Gates Foundations and YMCAs to the community-based community foundation or the local multi-service organization. All those organizations make up our membership. I think the wave of the future is to harness the wisdom and the innovation in this room. So what we'd like to do is invite you all to join us. And I'll explain why. Because you in this room are bridgers. You are the hinge between my generation and the emerging generation you represent, and you believe that institutions need transformation. You want to express your good in doing that. This is desperately needed. Folks in my role often don't know how to engage and create an environment that allows for the organization to transform, to create pathways where you're both learning and contributing. So at Independent Sector, we've created a brand new category of membership. We'd like to invite those of you who are interested to join our organization. AMI has been terrific in helping us think this thing through. And from now until our national conference, which will be in Detroit, the 25th through the 27th of October of this year, we want to invite you all to help us figure out how to reach folks like you, who are wanting to co-create, to innovate, to transform the sector, to meet the very challenges of today. So in the room is Troy Atkins. Where are you, Troy? Right here. Troy is my colleague who runs all of our membership work. For those that are interested, you can go to this website or you can talk to Troy. And we would like to convene a group of folks. Ideally, we're hoping to then bring you to Detroit to really help us think through how we would harness the smarts and innovation. You, as a group, are particularly important to us because you have done the hard work of getting a credential. You have taken the time to say, intentionality, skills in the sector matter. We believe that. So please, join us if you have the time and bandwidth. We need your help to really think about the future. So this is our generation reaching out and saying, let's co-create and innovate. So finally, before I open up to questions, I thought it was important to talk a little bit about my own story so that you could see it isn't a neat and tidy package that some of us have. So when I was 34 years old, I had the wonderful opportunity of taking over the network operations for Communities and Schools, one of the nation's largest youth serving organizations and the largest dropout prevention organization. The dirty secret was I had managed only two people up to that point and a budget no greater than $70,000. I was taking over a unit of 32 people and $6 million. And I was deeply underskilled. But the organization took a risk to say, we will help you learn these skills because you did have training as a community organizer. And we didn't have that skill, they said. So you come, we'll work with you, and then let's co-create and redesign how we engage our whole network operations. So in 1999, we were serving about 350,000 students across the United States. Last year when I left, we were serving 1.5 million. Because an institution took a risk on someone that didn't have the perfect skill set, but was willing to learn. So what were the characteristics that I think helped me move forward and help that institution support me? There are three. The first is self-reflection. You all right now are in a moment where you're in universities, you're in programs. There is structure, there are teachers, there is a pathway forward. That at some point, very soon, will end. And you will no longer have someone guiding your learning. That will get tossed to you. It is your first and most important opportunity to innovate, to find out what good means for you and how you want to express that in your daily life. If you don't build this muscle now, you will stall. The second thing is, we as people can't reflect by ourselves. I know you think you can, and we always have, we want quiet and reflect. We are by nature social beings. So we learn in relationship to the world. My point to you all today is be intentional about the communities that you select. Do not let serendipity determine your communities. Some of you will be blessed to have communities presented to you. You will be the exception, not the rule. Search out the places where you want to learn and innovate. Figure out the institutions and the pack you want to run with. And then finally, search out your teachers. Again, you've had this experience already. Many of you have intentionally opted into this program. You've gone to one teacher or professor over another. Don't stop being intentional. Search out the mentors who will help guide your learning. Let me give you an example of how intentional I think this has to be. I remember about 10 years ago, a young man who was about 21 at the time had just finished college. And a friend referred him to me because he was interested in a career in the nonprofit sector. He said, would you be a mentor? I said, sure, I've mentored some folks, happy to do it. We met for lunch. Thought he was a very, very smart young man and had a lot of desire to do good in the world. And he said, I take this mentoring thing very seriously. I didn't tell him this, he told me this. So for 5 years, every quarter, or sometimes five times a year, he would invite me to lunch, and 2 days before I met with him, he sent me three questions. And he was incredibly intentional about saying, here's what I'm confronting in my personal life, here's what I'm confronting in my professional life, and here's what I think I need to learn. Help me answer these questions. Not tell me the answer, but let's have a conversation. He carried the responsibility for his mentorship with me. I learned an immense amount from this young person, and I'm still very much in relationship with him, and now kind of having this much more peer relationship. So I would be remiss if I didn't share what I believe to be the characteristics that will allow you to tap what you think good is in the world. And I really want to just end by one thanking AMI. I want to open up for questions, but I want to make one last really invitation. The sector needs your wisdom. We need your smarts. We need your willingness to hang in there. Failure is part and parcel of what we experience every day. It is some of the richest learning that you will do. We need you to come help us innovate an independent sector. We need you to help us, in a sense, fail forward as we figure out how to do good in the 21st century. So again, thank you very, very much. Congratulations on having gotten this far. And let's open it up for questions, although maybe I'm running out of time.
Nope.
Great.
I'm just going to tell you, thank you very much. Wonderful presentation, Dan.
Well, thank you, Gordon.
Just going to tell you, we have two students in the room, so please ask Dan all of your wonderful questions.
Disagree, give me your best thinking, how can we get better? I see, is that a person coming in over there? No. Thoughts, comments? Oh, come on, it's not that early. All right, thank you.
Hi, I'm Kelsey.
Where are you from, Kelsey?
I go to University of San Diego.
Great.
Yes.
Beautiful.
My question to you is, how exactly do you want us to engage with you? I know you talked about kind of getting out of the sectors a bit more and doing CSR and helping at the event that you have in October. But what exactly are you expecting from us? Is it an internship? Is it giving time? Is it marketing? That type of thing.
So great question. And I guess part of it is, what do you all need? So this is what I think is happening. I think we're about to step into probably 5 to 10 years of business, government, and the social sector being either change happening to us or us being part of that change. And I think there are some predictable ways that we can think about that, technology being a great example of that. Think of just fundraising. When I first started in this work, direct mail was a really powerful tool, right? The notion of crowdsourcing, like who would ever, well, like what is that? Now that's a very powerful vehicle. And some folks disinvested in direct mail and they realized actually, no, you actually have to have both. So now you need a whole unit that has very different sets of strategies. So there's just, I think there's tons for us to learn. And this notion in my own experience is you all, by dint of just being in the generation that you're in and being out in the world, are bringing tons of creative ideas. So, first and foremost, be in relationship with us. Let's talk about what our opportunities are and challenges, and we'll figure out the pathway forward. That's what we're hoping to do with this website. Other questions, comments? Anybody disagree with anything that I said? All right. Hi.
I don't disagree. I'm a non-traditional student from Detroit, Michigan.
Fabulous.
And some of us are already working with very small, established, or new
Do I need to start over, or was I loud enough?
You're good, okay, I guess.
Good. Thank you. How do you see very small startup nonprofits, as well as some small established nonprofits, working within the independent sector, as well as us non-traditional students helping the independent sector with your new endeavor?
Yep. So you have two very different questions. So the first question is, how do I think about a small startup? Right? The question I ask is, what is it that that startup, those individuals, are seeing that the ecosystem is not enabling them to join or express or engage? And are they learning something that's critically important? So I think that is a posture towards reality. A lot of folks in my generation, and I have been there, like, please don't start another nonprofit. Oh my God, we have too many. I think that's the wrong frame. I think the frame is, when there is a desire to start something, some people are just entrepreneurs and they want to do it, and that's great. But if traditional institutions are unable to be places where you, with your core idea, can't see something, that's something we have to learn. So that is the second part of your question. We at the independent sector want to create an environment where non-traditional folks, folks who are not historically part of the mainstream sector, have a very dynamic place, because this is from my training as a community organizer. The places on the margins of community are the most creative. And so when you have a community being dominated by center decision makers, you're fundamentally missing important insights. So our organization wants to expand out to the peripheries and figure out the tension point and the kind of going back and forth. So that's how we're thinking about it. They respond? Great. Other thoughts? I don't know how much more time I have, but way in the back over here, over here, over here.
Hi, my name is Elena.
Hey, Elena. Where are you from?
I live in Denver, actually. I'm
here
at the University of Colorado, Denver.
So you have snow boots.
Yeah. We were prepared. So this kind of plays into what you were just talking about, even with institutions changing to the workforce, the incoming workforce. But I'm wondering, what sort of words of encouragement do you have for the incoming employees when the nonprofit workforce right now is kind of made up of a lot of women and minority employees, but it's still led predominantly by white males? So,
for example.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we are hoping that you guys will change faster, but how can we kind of adjust to getting into that workforce and showing our value and overcoming kind of institutional barriers that we face?
Great. It's a great question. It's also a complicated question, so I'm going to do a couple of things. First of all, I don't think you all should wait for permission. I think it is about demanding power and driving for change. So that's just my posture towards that, to start with. Number two is that my experience is there is, so there's a race and class overlay to the gender issue, right? And so my hope in responding to your colleague here is that we at Independent Sector open up our parameters and democratize what it means to be on the stage and begin to look for mechanisms whereby people's experiences aren't just a CEO's experience, but are mid and direct frontline folks as valid places where innovation and learning take place. So we're trying to create a mechanism where power is shared by virtue of who has control over the agenda. It will take us some time. But my central point is, I would rather have you do exactly what you just said is, hey there, white guy, are you intentionally making pathways for shared leadership? And that's a very serious question that I think I'm trying to wrestle with. I fail a great deal of the time, but certainly we've made some strides, I think, certainly at communities and schools where I worked before, who were primarily women. I think one or two more questions more. This is now getting good. You guys are getting into the meat of things. We should have just started with the questions.
Hi, I'm Allie.
Hey, Allie, where are you from?
Bloomington, Indiana, at
nice.
IU. Did you actually have any concrete tips on how to build a reflective muscle?
So all three of the things that I talked about were linked.
Okay.
I think there are lots of, you hear a lot about mindfulness now. A lot of you, how many people do yoga? Just raise your hand. Yeah. So you're already in a reflective mode. There are multiple mechanisms, and I think this generation has lots of strategies. I am a very, very strong believer in a certain amount of journaling or quiet time. So that's number one. But you can't, you got to be in community with other people. So how many people do book clubs? Anybody do book clubs? Another great example. Anybody besides this organization belong to professional organizations? Raise your hand. Great. So the mechanism's already there. The mentorship thing is the piece that I think most of us fail at. I have relied on serendipity. So if the tip that I was going to give you most, search out those people that you want to emulate, number one. And number two is search out someone that you envy and have a conversation with them. It's easy to go with that person you think, oh God, I want to be just like her. She is fabulous. It's much harder to sit down and say, I don't really like that person, but they're incredibly successful. What is it that they're doing that I could learn from? That would be the only concrete kind of tip. Yep. One last question.
Hi. Thank you for being here today, first of all.
My pleasure.
My name is Lisa. I'm from Michigan.
And where I'm in Michigan? Is,
Grand Rapids.
Oh. So,
a little bit over from Detroit. But,
yeah, Western Michigan. Great.
Yep. I'm here as an AmeriCorps alum. And one of the things you said that I found very interesting was this future relationship between private sector, nonprofit, and government, and working together. So I was wondering if you have experienced any relationships between those three sectors, and have you found that sweet spot and figured out, like, what does that look like? That's what I'm wanting to know.
Yeah. I haven't. I find that there are pockets of it right now. So yesterday, I came in early and I met with a local, a regional foundation, the Piton Foundation. Anybody know about them from Colorado? Right. They have a B Corp that's attached to their foundation. And so we sat for an hour talking about how they were using business analytics and philanthropic strategies and kind of traditional investor strategies, not really, like angel investing strategies. So they were really kind of mapping out the ecosystem and then looking at what the nonprofits and for-profits who needed to be part of that work. So it's happening across the country. The reason I met with them is I hope that independent sector, we could form a learning community where we could actually bring these folks together. Michigan has a really interesting, did you hear about Rock Ventures? Anybody know about Rock Ventures? So people have been following what's going on in Michigan, right? The bankrupt city and this kind of turnaround. The turnaround has come between the for-profit and government and the philanthropic sector. It's one of the most interesting case studies in America right now. I would highly recommend you take a look at it. Rock Ventures is the guy who founded Quicken Loans. Some of you may have student loans with them. They have this term that they use for their work. They believe moral and market are two sides of the same coin. So they're agnostic of whether investing in a nonprofit or a for-profit in Detroit. They just want to see good being done in that community. So there are lots of examples. They're not knit together quite thoroughly yet. One last question over here. I was not. That's good to know. So Troy, did you get that? It was, so great example, going right on technology and saying, are you aware that your the membership thing, the birth to be able to register is 1988? Right. We'll take care of that. How many people were born after 1988? Oh. So that's great news for us. Any other tips like this, by the way? Because we want to get this right. Perfect example, right? So I want to thank you all. And I did hear that you all are snowed in. You can't go out, which is a huge bummer. But I also think it's a phenomenal opportunity of adaptive leadership. So good luck with that. And I look forward to staying in relationship with you. And I look forward to working with those who kind of opt in to co-create the future of independent sector. Thanks very much. Have a great rest of the conference.